Hi, AppSec Engineers. Welcome to another video of The Way of the Future. In this video, we'll be talking about GitHub Actions and how you can specifically use GitHub Actions to trigger a bunch of different DevSecOps workflows. Let's get started. We're going to be constantly putting out content on AppSec, cloud security, container security, DevSecOps, and Kubernetes security. Now, if you like this sort of content, you should consider liking and subscribing to this channel on YouTube. In addition, it would be great if you could follow us on Twitter and on LinkedIn. GitHub Actions has probably emerged as one of the most important pieces of tech in the DevOps and CI/CD scene. So it's only natural that your organization or your project might want to use GitHub Actions for triggering DevOps and DevSecOps workflows. In this video, we're going to be looking at an example of how you can trigger SAST workflows with GitHub Actions. In addition, we're also going to explore some of the more advanced capabilities of GitHub to be able to consume various types of reports from SAST tools using a standard format called the Sarif. All of this is going to be very interesting. I highly recommend you watch till the end of the video. Let's get started with the rest of this presentation. So now what we're going to do is we are going to create our own project in GitHub. We're going to clone this existing project to our local machines. And then we are going to change the remote URLs for that local machine, for the Git repository, to push it to our newly created repository on GitHub. And then we're going to run the scan with GitHub Actions pointing to our new repository that we've just created. So let's finish that up. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new repository here, and I'm going to call this GH Actions Node.js scan. Okay, so this is going to be a public repository, just like we've done before. Very simple. Just going to create a repository and get started with it. We're going to push our existing code to this repository from this point on. So I'm going to first clone the repository that actually has all my code, the actual code along with the Node.js code, along with the GitHub Action workflows and all of that stuff. I'm going to first clone it to my local machine. So that's going to be git clone this particular repository. Now, once I'm going to clone this, I'm going to change the remote. So the remote currently going to be set to this. Now, I don't want that because I want it to actually run on my GitHub repository project. So I'm going to change the git remote. So if you cd into gh actions node.js scan and then run git remote hyphen v, you'll see that it's currently pointing to the AppSec Engineer repository, and we want to change that. We want to point it to our GitHub project as the remote. So what we're going to do is we are going to make this the actual remote. So we're going to say git remote set URL origin this. We're going to change this to the newly created repository that we have, a personal repository that we just created. Now what we're going to do is we're going to make a small change to this in Visual Studio Code. I'm just making that small change just to make sure that we have something in the commit that we're doing. And we're going to make a small change to this. I'm just going to add a comment somewhere saying added new repo and GitHub Actions. That's it, literally just that. And now we're going to commit all of this into our repositories. Say a git commit hyphen added a new code base actions. Now, before we actually commit and see what is happening, let's look at the action itself. And it's a very simple workflow that we have. So this is going to trigger on push to the master branch or the pull request to the master branch. And this is going to just check out the code first. So this is running a job called job ID called node.js scan or njs scan. The job name is njs scan check. So that's the job name. The job has two steps. One is the checkout step, which is just going to check out the code, and then it is going to run node.js scan on the local directory or on the current directory. So that's why we have the dot notation. So it's going to run this, which is an existing node.js scan action. So it's already an existing node.js scan action that we can pull from the GitHub Actions marketplace that we already saw. So that's it. We're just leveraging that which is there already and then pushing it out. So I'm going to push here. So it's been pushed to the new remote URL.
Now, if I go back here, we should see that our action must have started triggering, which it has. And you will see that it's running the action. And it should check out the code. And then finally, job will fail because this is a vulnerable code base. In fact, it has a bunch of security issues that I know of for sure. And as a result, you will see that it is a vulnerable application and it's going to fail the build. Now, this actually, Node.js scan, for those of you who are interested, is actually running the Semgrep engine under the hood. So it's actually leveraging Semgrep to actually do its analysis. So it has a bunch of Semgrep rules that it's leveraging to actually perform its analysis, so which is really nice. That's much more accurate than it used to be. Although it was a pretty good tool even before, it used to use regexes. But with Semgrep coming in, I think there was a lot more improvement to the quality of the rules that Node.js scan gives you. So it's a really powerful scanning tool for Node.js projects. I highly recommend it if you're using Node.js. And it's, of course, open source and free, so it's always nice to have that. So it's running the scan, and it should take us a little bit more time to finish up the scan. And once it's done, you will see that it should fail the build because the scan produces a bunch of security issues which will fail the build. And you see that, as I mentioned, it's failing the build because it's found a bunch of security issues. It found server-side request forgery. It would have probably found some SQL injections. It would have probably found a bunch of other things. So this is clearly a vulnerable code base. So it clearly means that it's failed because it's a vulnerable code base. If it was not, let's say there were no findings, or let us say you had set up a threshold to say that only fail on high severity or something like that, that's when you could have essentially, it would have passed. I don't think even then it would have passed because you still have a lot of high severity findings. But for the most part, you can set up those kind of things as well. So let's say you only want to fail the build on high severity findings, that's fine. But in many cases, if you want to fail it on any kind of findings, this would be the way to do because you're essentially failing the entire build itself. So this is something that you can use when you are leveraging static analysis workflows with GitHub Actions. So it's really nice to use that. So it gives you all the rules, it gives you the OWASP category of what it found, and then it of course tells you what is the severity of that finding. So it tells you that it's an error severity finding, so it tells you that that is a vulnerable issue that it has. So in this lab extension that we're doing, what I'm going to be doing is going a little bit off book. So what we're going to do is we're going to push these Node.js scan results to our GitHub code scanning insights. So in our GitHub repository, we have a code scanning insights that we can use. So if you look at the security tab here, you can actually set up code scanning alerts. Now we obviously don't have any code scanning alerts, and even though we've run actions and even though we've done static analysis against this very project, as you can see here, we've not really set it up to add these findings to GitHub in GitHub security tab and GitHub for that particular repository. We've not really set it up. So we're going to do that because this tool gives us the ability to do that. For that, the tool has to be able to output results into the Sarif file format. So if it's able to output results into the Sarif file format, what GitHub does is that it parses that particular format and then it's able to consume it through GitHub's static analysis API and then show up all those results in the code scanning alerts. So that's what we're going to do in this. So in this, we're going to make a small change to our existing workflows.yaml file and add a few things to that particular workflow.yaml file. In fact, you have the thing you need to do right here. I'm just going to show you how it works and why it works the way it works. So I'm going to just add a definition called Sarif here, and we're going to say output this to results.sarif. So that's what we're going to do. And we are going to pipe that to true. Now, the reason we are piping it to true is because we don't want the job to fail. Because if the job fails, it will not execute the next step. That's why we're piping it to true. So let's say it finds a bunch of security issues. It is automatically going to fail the job because it produces a non-zero exit code. So by doing this pipe to true, what we're forcing it to give you a zero exit code so that it continues with the next job. So that's why you have this pipe true being done here. That's why you have that. And it's sometimes we have to use it for static analysis tools because a lot of static analysis tools have this automatic kind of orientation. If they find vulnerabilities, they're going to fail that, or they produce the non-zero exit code, which is going to fail the build when they're running in ACI/CD for toolset. Now, the next step that we are going to do is upload report. So we're going to upload report to GitHub code scanning. So we're going to upload this to the code scanning alerts. And for that, we are going to use this existing action. Now, this is the cool part about GitHub Actions. So I just have to literally use this action and I'm done. I don't have to think about, oh, do I have to write this? Do I need to script it up? Nothing. Do I need to access the API through this particular approach? No, it's already there. Again, this you have to use with a pinch of salt, because I would recommend that you look at this particular action, which is in the marketplace. And then if you want to look at this action in the marketplace, look at the source code for that action. Try and look at the source code, look at what it's doing, look at how it's doing what it's doing, and then go ahead and actually use the action. Just don't blindly use the action. Just like you have supply chain security issues where you're running somebody else's code, remember that somebody else's code might also be targeted to compromise you. So I would recommend always reading the code base, just understand what it's doing, see if it was from a trusted source or somebody or some developer that seems to be well known in the community, or at the very least, look at the code and see what it's doing. So in this case, it seems to be from GitHub itself, this particular action. So it's cool. It seems to be a lot more trusted. And I would still recommend you read it, but definitely look at all those parameters, just like you would go about certain checks before you install a Android app or an iOS app on your phone. I recommend you do the same thing for any of these integrations and add-ons that you're using. So I'm going to do the same thing. So I am using this action here. And then finally, I am going to just push the Sarif file to that action. So you can see that I'm literally just copy pasting at this point. So it makes it a lot easier for me to get moving with this workflow. Now what I'm going to do is I am going to add this. I'm going to say added Sarif integration git push, and I'm going to push this, and it's going to trigger another job, and hopefully this time it's going to push it to the code scanning alerts in my GitHub action. So let's see what it's doing. Now it's added the Sarif integration, and we're going to see it should do what we wanted to do. Now remember, it's not going to fail this time around. So the previous time we ran this task, since we had findings from Node.js scan, it failed the build. And since we had findings, it failed the build. But this time, remember, we've added that pipe true. So once we've added that pipe true, you'll see that it's going to produce a zero exit code. So it should not fail the build. And it should also write it to GitHub code scanning. So that is going to be a thing that we should get. Probably needs a little bit of time to run the static analysis. And once it's done, you will see that it push this to GitHub code scanning. And it's done. And you can see that it didn't fail this build at all, because remember, we have the pipe true, so it didn't fail. Otherwise, it would have failed the build and it wouldn't have actually written to code scanning, because that would have stopped the flow of the pipeline. In this case, what we've done is we've done a static analysis scan, and then we have uploaded the results to GitHub code scanning. So from here, this is a good way to do this as well, because you can actually triage the results. Now you see that we have alerts in code scanning, and you'll see that you can actually triage the results and then say whether it's an actual result or it's a false positive. You might have false positives, right? It's not always that you have a true positive. Tools are based on rules, and sometimes you might have certain error conditions that they show up with. So in this case, you'll see that most of them are not. I think in this case, for the most part, we have genuine results. The NoSQL injection thing, the SQL injection thing, we know that's possible. YAML.load, remote code execution, unserialized, that also has remote code execution possibility. So I know for a fact that this is vulnerable to all these issues. And the cool thing now is that I can see this entirely on GitHub and start to comment on it, or start to figure this out, or start to fix it, or I can dismiss it. So let's say it's a false positive, then I can fix it. That's really cool. That's one of the benefits of pushing this to GitHub code scanning itself. So in this example, what we did was we first look at Node.js scan as part of a static analysis GitHub Actions workflow, and then we used the Sarif capability of GitHub Actions and of course Node.js scan since it supports it, and pushed those results into GitHub code scanning alerts, which gave us all of this information right on GitHub's on repository security tab. So that's one of the benefits that we had with code scanning alerts.
If you liked that video, you should consider liking and subscribing to our YouTube channel. Follow us on LinkedIn and Twitter. And if you want the best quality education for AppSec, cloud native security, Kubernetes, DevSecOps, threat modeling, and a constantly updated library of amazing courses with amazing hands-on labs, you should get a subscription for AppSecEngineer.com. Subscriptions are available for both individuals and teams of any size that you can access on AppSecEngineer.com. Please check us out.